For the most part, the Oilers are a set team. They are not looking to make many changes this season. One of the new faces to watch for in the lineup tonight is rookie defenseman Colin Bauer. He has been the best of all the prospects in camp. Soviet Anatoly Semenov will play tonight. Semenov is a candidate to replace Yari Kurri at right wing. However, the Oilers coach John Muckler thinks that job may go to another product of Finland, Esa Tikkanen.
I talked to Esa Tikkanen yesterday and asked him if he would mind playing on the right side or if he had any objections to it as far as attitude in his case of not being able to play in that position. He said he would like to try that. So that's one possibility. Other possibilities, Rzyzka on the right side now, Semenov's on the right side. So there's three possibilities there, and I'm sure we'll come up with some more before we've completed the game in Calgary.
Tikkanen won't play in tonight's game. Ken Linsman will dress for the Oilers this evening. He has taken control in the battle for the job as the third-line center. Netminder Mike Greenlay will play behind Bill Ranford tonight. Greenlay is battling Pokey Redick for the number two netminding job with the Oilers. This is Rod Phillips for Eyewitness Sports.
The kid line was back together for the Oilers last night, and they played the way they did in the playoffs last spring. Joe Murphy got the Oilers rolling with an early goal. The center on the line, Adam Graves, had two goals and was a physical factor throughout the contest. But the story of the 9-4 win over Calgary was the McTavish-Buchberger-Semenov line.
Semenov showed that he can play in the National Hockey League. He's a very clever hockey player. Buchberger made some great moves, a great pass. I guess it was on Semi's first goal. And McTavish played well in the middle.
McTavish scored this third period goal to give the Oilers a 7-1 lead. He also had three assists, a four-point night, the same as new line mate Semenov.
Unbelievable ability, and he's very popular in the room too, not only on the ice but in the dressing room too. He's working hard to get the language and he wants to learn and wants to play the system over here, and I think combine that with all the natural ability that he has, and I think it looks like we got a great player.
Besides two goals, Semenov also set up two other goals, including this one by Kelly Buchberger that gave the Oilers a 4-1 lead. Corey Elliott, Eyewitness Sports.
You know, 2-1. Later in the period, Steve Yzerman on the rush. The shot, but Bester comes up with the save and a dandy one at that. Detroit still leads by a score of 2-1. Vinny Danforth with the pass to Marois. He gets the goal, and it's 2-2. Let's go to the third period. Game still tied. Yzerman on the move. To the outside, goes to the net, the shot, again, he gets stoned. Bill McDougall, the shot, but another save. Detroit will finally break the tie. McDougall out in front, Gerard Gallant, the one-timer, he catches the corner. Detroit goes on to win the final in the hockey.
For in that game from Scott Russell.
Denny Savard makes his forum debut in the red, white, and blue, and he's wearing the captain's C to boot. The home team gets off to a good start. Mark Peterson completes a 3-on-1 rush. Peterson beats Bill Ranford 1-0 Montreal. Denny Savard makes it 2-0 on an unassisted effort before the first period is out. The forum faithful just a little pleased with that. 26 seconds into the second period, Stéphane Lebeau scores on Ranford to make it 3-1 Canadiens. The kid leading the kid line to glory. Edmonton gets on the board as Kim Issel gets one by a stingy Brian Hayward to make it 3-1. But Mark Peterson storms down to the other end. He fires
his... Peterson's action.
It was 2 days before the Oilers' season opener and the second day of Glenn Anderson's retirement. A move that shocked general manager Glenn Sather.
I mean, by shutting off your avenue of communication, I think is a big mistake. You're never going to work your problems out if you can't sit down and talk. And by Glenn just saying that he's going to retire and leave town, nobody knows where he is. I mean, he's never going to get anything solved. So, and you'd have to look at this as, yeah, he has retired and he's finished playing hockey.
Anderson, reportedly looking for his $300,000 a year salary to be tripled, has support amongst his teammates. Particularly his center, Mark Messier.
I think he's absolutely right in what he's doing right now, and I've heard a little bit of talk about greed amongst players, but I mean, how many players can be greedy in what they've done here in the past? And he deserves to be paid more, and hopefully that they'll come to terms.
Messier, too, is looking for a renegotiated contract and is believed to be looking for a deal in line with the likes of Gretzky, Lemieux, and Hull. But Sather had a message for all the Oilers.
The reality is that you can't keep passing off million-dollar contracts to the fans. It's virtually impossible in a city the size of Edmonton.
I think that the players deserve an equal share of the earnings that are being benefited by the owners, and we're not being greedy. We just want our share of it, just like any other leagues.
Again, we still haven't heard from Glenn Anderson, but I'm told that Mark Messier and Glenn Sather met this afternoon. No word on whether they've made any progress on Messier's hoping to renegotiate his deal. Well, it's quite a day in sport. The NHL season opens tonight, and so does the Major League playoffs. But it's a day Reggie Taylor of the Eskimos in Chicago.
Tonight from coast to coast in Canada, our coverage features from the Forum in Montreal. A hero's welcome for Denny Savard as Savard suits up for the Canadiens against the Buffalo Sabres. We'll take you to the Northlands Coliseum in Edmonton, where John Muttler must surely be anxious over all the developments in camp this year, but you'd never know it to look live at Northlands Coliseum and see a smiling face of Mark Messier. Messier hoisting the cup as they unfurl banner number 5. The Oilers, champions for the 5th time in 7 years, are set to provide their season and home opener against the Winnipeg Jets. And there's a look at the Oilers captain, Mark Messier, moments ago as he brought the Stanley Cup to center ice for some 17,000 adoring fans. And at the Olympic Saddle Dome in Calgary tonight, we'll have the matchup featuring Doug Risebrough and the Calgary Flames against Doug Carpenter and the Toronto Maple Leafs. Good evening and welcome to Molson Hockey Night in Canada on CBC. I'm Ron McLean. Tonight, we commence our 60th year of this program, 38 of those seasons on television. And one of the new wrinkles will be a national emphasis. We'll still have regional coverage. In other words, fans in Montreal will see their Canadians, in Calgary their Flames, and in Toronto their Leafs. But through it all, we'll weave together stories and highlights from all of our broadcast centers, tonight being the Forum, the Saddle Dome, and Northlands Coliseum.
And that means one thing, hockey. And that means the renewal of another fall tradition, the 60th season of Hockey Night in Canada, the 36th year on television. Last season, one of the best playoff rounds came from the Smythe Division, where the Oilers battled the Jets in a classic 7-game series. In Game 4, Dave Ellett got the winner for the Jets in an overtime thriller. The Oilers win the series in 7 with this breakaway goal from an unlikely hero, Mark Lamb. En route to their 5th Stanley Cup, the Oilers' stiffest challenge came from the Winnipeg Jets. Hi, everyone, and welcome to a brand new season of Molson Hockey Night in Canada on CBC. I'm Steve Armitage, along with Chris Cuthbert and John Garrett. We're coming to you live from the Northlands Coliseum in Edmonton, where the defending Stanley Cup champions, the Edmonton Oilers, will take on the Winnipeg Jets. This is the regular season opener for the Edmonton Oilers. The Winnipeg Jets have already played one game. They humiliated the Toronto Maple Leafs 7-1 in their season opener. However, all is not well in Oiler country. They are going into this opening game with a lot of questions, more questions than answers, mainly because of two big names, Grant Fuhr being suspended, and now Glenn Anderson, who is AWOL from the Edmonton Oilers lineup. The Winnipeg Jets, on the other hand, are very, very confident. They feel they can go a long way in the Smythe Division and perhaps challenge the Edmonton Oilers and the Calgary Flames. Right now, let's go upstairs for the national anthem.
Your Metro Edmonton Chrysler dealers. That's some score during tonight's first period intermission.
Banner, and already, John, a lot of emotion here.
An impressive ceremony.
No introduction as the starting goaltender for the Edmonton Oilers. He had a roller coaster series against the Jets, but he used it as a springboard to win the Conn Smythe and Stanley Cup.
The Jets, very casual. They knew they had a penalty coming up, and they just stood around and watched the Oilers. The Oilers had two great chances because the Jets were just standing around. Look at the Jet coverage here. Puck goes around behind the net.
Into the corner. Oilers like to get a shot, but they won't. comes back to the point.
We are tied at three here at the Northlands Coliseum. The Oilers 3, the Winnipeg Jets 3. Now let's go to the Forum in Montreal, where the fans are still celebrating. Now watch the move by Denny Savard. Everybody is chasing Denny Savard. That frees up a couple of players. Stéphane Richer will get the puck and beat Buffa with the backhand. That makes it 5-4, Montreal leading the Buffalo Sabres. Great moves by Denny Savard. Well, this season on Hockey Night in Canada, Inside Hockey returns. This is what the popular intermission feature at E1.
Inside Hockey, a season preview. Skyrocketing salaries in the NHL, triggered by the summer signings of the Blues' Brett Hull and Scott Stevens. Now several other stars want to renegotiate. NHL expansion. 11 applicants from 10 cities, including two from Canada. Hunger for big league hockey. And there are three applicants from Florida. The entry fee, $50 million. We'll look at Bob Gainey, a rookie coach with a big challenge. Can he revive the muddled Minnesota North Stars? Mario Lemieux is out, recovering from back surgery. When will he return? We'll focus on last year's MVP, Mark Messier, and Norris Trophy winner, Ray Bourque. And we'll meet big Eric Lindros of Oshawa, the number one prospect for the 1991 entry draft. We'll go stargazing from New York to L.A. and all around the league and talk to a new wave of celebrities who've been turned on to hockey. What attracts them to the game? Reflecting on past greats, we'll meet old faces in new surroundings. Marcel Dion, third on the all-time point-scoring list, now a dry cleaner extraordinaire in a New York suburb, says he's never been happier. Gary Curry, now a member of the Milan Devils in Italy, the biggest star in European hockey. Italy loves him, the Oilers miss him. Whatever happened to Tiger Williams? From dawn to dusk, Tiger works as a West Coast developer building townhouse condominiums, but he still misses hockey. These are just some of the stories we'll be bringing you on Inside Hockey this season.
And coming up next, the first of Inside Hockey, the Edmonton Oilers in Germany. Here at the Northlands Coliseum, the Oilers are tied with the Winnipeg Jets at 3. Live, this is Molson Hockey Night in Canada on CBC.
Winning their fifth Stanley Cup in May. For the Oilers, it meant a trip to Europe to compete in the Epson Cup, along with the St. Louis Blues and the German league champions from Dusseldorf. And the Oilers discovered very quickly that here in Germany, they take their hockey seriously.
But the exuberant capacity crowd would not see a victory.
They weren't even getting any shots on Bill Ranford, but the Jets do have an explosive team. They've got a very mobile.
Opening with 2 minutes and 14 seconds left in regulation time. And if Rick Tabarachi wasn't going to remember his first NHL game, he will now. Tabarachi against Jeff Bukavum. And I'm sure Bukavum never thought he'd be in this position.
And look at him. Jeff Bukavum's getting a little chuckle out of it. He's looking over at the bench. Some razzing from his teammates on the bench.
With the game.
Stanley Cup. And the Flames going into their second game as they try to regain the form that led them to the NHL championship 2 years ago. Many are predicting it will be the Flames' year again. The Oilers hosted the Jets, and the Flames were home to the Leafs. Let's go to Northlands Coliseum first, where the Oilers raised their fifth Stanley Cup banner before the game. It was Mark Messier carrying the trophy onto the ice amongst all the dry ice and all the action. And then they raised the banner for the 1990 Stanley Cup championship. And things started out well for the Oilers as Steve Smith scored the first Oiler goal with assists from Messier and Craig Simpson. It was 1-0 Oilers in the first. Oilers sophomore winger Martin Jelena shows great moves here as he turns Dave Ellett inside out, then gets his own rebound from Rick Tabarachi and puts it in. Oilers led 2-0. But the Jets would come back to 2-on-1. Fenton to Ashton. He gives a look and fires it by Ranford, who got a piece of the puck, but not enough. Cuts the lead to 2-1. They tie it up when Phil Housley deflects a Teppo Numinum shot. 59 seconds later, a 2-2 tie. On the power play, it's Klima over to Simpson, and they're in the lead again. But the Jets came right back again. Elenick will get the first shot. As the Oilers drift by it, Doug Evans rushes in front of the goaltender and throws it over Ranford. All four goals scored in just over 2 minutes. One of the most exciting plays in hockey after Paul Fenton throws his stick at the puck. A penalty shot awarded to the Oilers. The referee says Jeff Bookaboom has to take it because he was closest to the puck. Book may be big, but he's not big on the score sheet. Tries for the five-hole, and Tabarachi makes the save. The game goes into overtime. Oilers have a great chance for the win. Craig Simpson with some nifty moves as he goes through the slot, but one too many, and he slides it by. The game ends in a 3-all tie. Rookie goaltender Rick Tabarachi for Winnipeg, the hero, as the Jets were outshot 31-19, and the Oilers dominated, especially in the third period. It ends in a 3-3 overtime tie. And tonight, it was the Oilers' turn as Toronto visited Edmonton. Penalties were a factor in this matchup as well. And early on, Peter Ng looking pretty good in the nets for the Leafs. They had good pressure, the Oilers did. He makes a couple of saves to keep the puck out and the game scoreless. Later in the period, Rob Ramage would take a penalty. He's in the box as things get a little rough. And they go on the scramble again in front of Ng. Charlie Huddy keeps the puck in, lets the shot go. Joe Murphy gets the rebound and a power play goal, 1-0 Edmonton. A defensive miscue for the Leafs. Brian Curran falls on this clearing attempt. And Jeff Bookaboom walks into the shot, surprises Ng for the Oilers' second goal. They're up 2-0. But the Leafs would come back. In the second period, Daniel Marois scores for the Leafs. They're on the power play this time, deflecting the point shot from Ranage past Bill Ranford, cutting the lead to 2-1. The Oilers would score to get back the two-goal lead. Joe Murphy again, his second. As the puck goes back to the point, Murphy deflects it in faster than the camera can follow. 3-1 Edmonton. Peter Ng was strong in the Leafs' net, as they said. They scored early in the third period, but the second night in as many young goalies played well against Edmonton. He makes save after save as the Oilers swarm all about. They score early in the third when Ed Olczyk takes advantage of a series of Edmonton giveaways that cuts the lead to 3-2. The Oilers continue to pressure with some two-on-ones. Tikkanen sends in Tony Semenov. He slips it under Ng, and it goes wide. Then Martin Jelena combines with Steve Graves. Jelena comes very close, taking their turn pass, but Ng makes the save again. Wasn't a defensive battle. The Oilers come out with their first win of the year, though, as Bookaboom scores and Murphy gets a pair. 3-2 over the Leafs. It wasn't pretty, but they'll take it.
Recognition of a Stanley Cup victory. It is something the city of Edmonton has witnessed five times in the past 7 years. Arguably the NHL's team of the decade. In the 1980s, the Edmonton Oilers hope the 1990s prove as fruitful. Certainly they started the new decade in style with their Stanley Cup win in Boston last May.
But it's now a new season, and a new season brings new challenges, new players, and all that is left of last year are the memories. And even they must be put aside in order to deal effectively with the present. Tonight, a look back at the Oilers' drive for five and their quest for number six and the stories surrounding each. Simply the best, the Edmonton Oilers, continues right after this.
Months since the great one had made his Hollywood exit to Los Angeles. The 88-89 season had been one of mourning, but with a new campaign came renewed hope to finally emerge from the shadow of Wayne Gretzky. But destiny didn't seem to be on the Oilers' side. Sunday, October 15th, game five of the 1989-90 season. Wayne Gretzky and his Los Angeles Kings were in town. The Oilers had witnessed many of Gretzky's accomplishments firsthand, and tonight they would see another. Gretzky had become the NHL's all-time leading scorer, surpassing his idol and friend, Gordie Howe. And he had done it in front of friends, family, former teammates, and in the city in which he, more than anyone, put on the map. This was hardly what the Oilers had in mind. The shadow was looming larger than ever. Adding to their woes was the fact the day before the Gretzky heroics, Jimmy Carson, the 50-goal scorer the Oilers received in the Gretzky deal, walked out on the club, demanding a trade. After 3 weeks of waiting, the trade finally came, Carson ending up with his hometown Detroit Red Wings, with the Oilers receiving in return Peter Klima, whose talents on the ice were often overshadowed by his actions off it. Joe Murphy, the first overall pick in the 86 draft, but had failed to live up to his potential in 4 years with the Wings. Adam Graves, a 21-year-old center the Wings drafted behind Murphy in 86. And Jeff Sharples, a 22-year-old defenseman who had bounced between the Wings and the Miners. It was a consensus of the Oilers brass that it was that trade that turned the Oilers into a legitimate Stanley Cup threat. Klima, Graves, and Murphy had an immediate impact on the hockey club, as much as the hockey club had an impact on them.
I think the biggest thing is maybe not the most talented team that wins, but the guys that stick together and play for each other. And I think if I learn one thing, it's how to, you know, try to fit into a team concept. And, you know, if you can use that in the rest of your days, even after hockey are finished, then, you know, you're going to be better off for it.
From there, the Oilers rolled into the playoffs, led by Mark Messier, enjoying his finest season in an Oiler uniform. The Oilers also reacquire Reho Ruotsalainen from New Jersey to quarterback the power play. All the pieces seem to be in place, except for one, Grant Fuhr. For him, 89-90 was a write-off. An appendectomy during training camp, a shoulder injury in December, and then re-injuring it in April, just before the playoffs. So heading into the Oilers' first playoff series against Winnipeg, the postseason pressure was on backup Bill Ranford. And given his performance in Game 1, there were those who thought Ranford had succumbed to that very pressure.
Time is on net being checked. Hawerchuk has a try to jam, and he scores! Olsson, cross ice, Dellett, there's the shot, scores! Gets it across to Clancy, scores from the blue line! Mo Mantha with a shot from the blue line that beats...
Ranford would rebound from his Game 1 performance, but still the club found itself down 3-1 and facing first-round elimination for the second straight year. Rarely in NHL history had clubs rebounded to win a series after being down 3-1, but the players kept the faith.
We believed in ourselves, and we had nothing to be ashamed of at that point. Even though we were down 3-1, we thought we'd played as well as can be expected. The Jets were just a little bit better, and we figured we'd take it one game at a time, as the old cliche goes, and battle hard. And if we played our best game, that we'd probably win one game at a time.
The Oilers took Game 5 at home, Game 6 in Winnipeg, and forcing a deciding Game 7 back in Edmonton. The Oilers would win it 4-1, and arguably the best series in the entire playoffs came to an end.
After being questioned by his own teammates after Game 1, when his team lost 7-5 here, Bill Ranford has been a star tonight.
Next up, the Los Angeles Kings, who had upset the heavily favored Calgary Flames in round 1. With Gretzky hampered by a sore back, the Kings had nothing left, bowing out in 4 straight, leaving Chicago as the only obstacle between the Oilers and another trip to the Stanley Cup Final. After getting up on the Oilers 2-1, the Hawks, having played more playoff games than any other club, started a tire. The Oilers would win the next 3 games and win the series 4-2.
The Edmonton Oilers have won the Campbell Conference Championship and will move on to the Stanley Cup Final against the Boston Bruins beginning Tuesday night at the Boston Garden.
So it was the Oilers and Boston Bruins in a rematch of the Stanley Cup Final of 1988. A classic matchup. Messier against Bort, leading candidates for the Hart Trophy. Bill Ranford against Andy Moog, traded for each other, and each with something to prove. Game 1, like the matchup, was a classic. Tied at 2 in the third overtime session, when little used, Peter Klima was suddenly turned into the game's hero.
Klima catching up. He's in. She scores! Klima! Gets the goal for the Edmonton Oilers here in the third overtime at 15-13. And what a win this has got to be for the Edmonton Oilers.
The Oilers would win Game 2 as well. And then the two clubs would split the 2 games in Edmonton, giving the Oilers an opportunity to win their first Stanley Cup on the road. Going through what they had the last 2 seasons, the Oilers weren't about to let the opportunity slip away. A 4-1 victory and their 5th Stanley Cup in 7 years.
The Edmonton Oilers, Stanley Cup champions 1990. did Kevin Law. You wouldn't know, but it was his first. They're just as good, I guess, Kevin. They're just as good. Doesn't matter the number, but you can see it on the face of Mark Messier. This one is as sweet as the other four. Maybe a little bit sweeter. He had another 30 saves in this one tonight. And that's nothing new to this young man. He has been superlative in goal for the Edmonton Oilers. And rightly receives from Mr. Ziegler the Conn Smythe Trophy.
Of the five Stanley Cup victories, this one was the least expected. Without Gretzky, without Pierre, and many thought without hope. And because of that, this one may be the one to savor more than any other.
There's a great bunch of guys in the dressing room, and you know, we showed a lot of character, and we really played well on the road in the playoffs, and you know, it's something we'll never forget.
Oh, I can't believe it. We really came together when we were down 3-1 in the Winnipeg series. We were down 3-1 in the first or second period against them, and the team gelled together. Billy, unbelievable. Deserved the Conn Smythe. He's just an awesome goalie. And, you know, all the lines started gelling together. And here we are now. We got the cup, and I'm getting a ring, and nothing could be better.
I'll tell you what, this guy better not go unnoticed, and that's John Muckler. Again and again, he comes up with the strategy and the tactics that make us a championship team. And it's just, I mean, that's the key. We're a good hockey team. But with the coaching that we have, it's just unbelievable.
Well, Gretz, I'll tell you one thing. Kevin and I are laying in bed this afternoon on a thing, and we went out and said, let's go win this one for Gretz, baby. And this is for you, Wayne, right here, baby, all the way. We love you.
But whether you finish first or 21st, invariably, there will be changes. It's the nature of the beast. And so it would be with the Stanley Cup champions. Season there had been contract talks with Jari Kurri, who had hinted throughout the year that he would head back to Europe to continue his career in Italy.
Oilers keep it in. Good play by Tikkanen. They score! Tikkanen made a great play at the blue line to prevent it from coming out.
And Jari Kurri scores his 90th playoff goal to win the first place in all-time NHL, passing his old buddy Wayne Gretzky.
During the Stanley Cup final with Boston, Kurri became the all-time leading scorer in NHL playoff history. But despite five Stanley Cup rings and being 26 goals away from the magic 500 plateau, the desire to move closer to his native Finland and represent his country in the upcoming World Championships in Helsinki won over. And on July 30th, Kurri officially announced he would be playing hockey in Italy this season. Reached by phone in Finland, Kurri admitted he was going to miss his Oiler teammates.
It's been a good time, and there's a lot of memories, you know, just to be a part of it. In a great, great team like the Oilers had, and the five Stanley Cups, and the playing with the Kurtz, you know, those are the things you can't forget, you know. Plus, you spent 10 years with such great teammates like Mets and Kevin and Andy and all those guys, you know.
For finish out of the playoffs, invariably there are changes, and so it is with the 1990-91 Edmonton Oilers. One of the new faces this year is...
I think we have enough guys here still that have been down this road before, and you know, the experience and the lessons that were learned by younger guys coming to our team last year, like the Graves and Murphy, Jelinas, Jeff Smith and whatnot, going to the Stanley Cup Finals is an invaluable experience, and they've seen what it takes to win, and you can use all those same lessons during your regular season. I think that it's important that we get off to a good start, and I think it's important for us to play consistent hockey all year, and we have enough depth, we have enough talent that we can do that, and if we are mentally prepared for it.
We are the champions of the National Hockey League, and everybody wants a piece of the champion, there's no question about that, and that's the way it should be. And you'd better be prepared to defend your championship, or you're not going to really fare too well in the coming year, because every night somebody's going to be coming at you. I know from the past that many times when you go into a visiting rink and they defeat you, and you read in the paper the next day that was the best game they've ever played in this season. Well, we're going to see many nights like that, and we have to be on top of our game, and we have to be prepared to play every night. If we're willing to do that, then I think we can challenge again. But from past history, I know that we're not going to be ready every night. I know that one of the main things that we have to do is we got to check our egos at the door when we start the season. We got to realize how we won the Stanley Cup. That was because of hard work, team concept, people working together. The willingness to work. And if we're willing to do that again, we should have another good year.